really applicable to our culture today. It's amazed me as I have aged, and we won't talk about how much I've aged, but as I've aged, to see the changes in our culture. And to recognize now, I think many, if not most Christians, don't recognize this, that our culture today has very much become very similar to what the culture that the first century church faced and had to deal with. And so I think the book of Colossians, as it has so much to do with the world in which they were struggling to live as Christians, I think we'll find a lot of meaningful lessons in there for us. But this morning, as we are desiring to step out in faith and to ask the Lord to bless the congregation here in His church the world over with growth, as we focus on evangelism and as we focus on our upcoming Bring a Friend Day on March 6th, as just one of the tools in our tool chest to grow in our evangelism, I wanted to take this tour, if you will, of Nehemiah briefly this morning and look at the success factors that are involved. If you know the story of Nehemiah, then you know that it contains one of the most incredible accomplishments in the entire scripture. Of course, in the history of physical fleshly Israel, the northern tribes had been carried off into captivity by the Assyrians and basically assimilated into the cultures of the day and disappeared from history. I still sometimes hear the phrase, the lost 10 tribes, and that phrase is a reference to the northern kingdom of Israel and how they disappeared from history after their captivity. And then sometime later, the remnant of Israel, Judah, was carried away into the Babylonian captivity. On Sunday nights right now, we're studying the book of Daniel, which occurs during that time frame. But the Babylonian captivity, unlike the Assyrian captivity from northern Israel, the Babylonian captivity was not designed by the Lord to be the end of the remnant of Israel. No, it was designed by the Lord to preserve the remnant of Israel, because they too had strayed away from serving God. They had fallen into idolatry and other practices and a failure to keep His commandments, and so it was a punishment, but it was the way that any good punishment is designed to be. It was designed not to simply injure, but it was designed to bring His people back to Him, to keep that remnant loyal to Him. And so that captivity lasted 70 years, and at the end of those 70 years, a priest named Zerubbabel took the first group back from the Babylonian captivity, back into Judah, back to Jerusalem. And that group set out with high hopes. It was only a small fraction of the remnant that had been taken into captivity in the first place that went back to Zerubbabel. But that group was committed. They were willing to leave the lives that they had settled into in the Babylonian Empire and to return to Judah and to reestablish the worship and the temple, which would need to rebuild, the city walls, which would need to be rebuilt. But the wrap of the story is, to a great extent, a story of failure. They got energetic. They became excited at the first, at the opportunity to go back and to restore their relationship with God. But when they went back, they encountered trouble and they encountered obstacles. They made a little progress and they started worshiping God again, but it never proceeded much beyond that. And so then, some 50 plus years later, almost 60 years later, Ezra led another group back from the Babylonian captivity. And this group, if you think about it, of course, was yet another generation into the Babylonian captivity. And the significance of that is the reason why so many of them do not come back got into a comfort zone in Babylonia. Naturally, the first group during the 70 years, some of them have died in that captivity. The rest, of course, have taken up new lines. A lot of them became successful merchants, businessmen, you know. And then, of course, by the time Ezra comes with his group, that's the generation that was born in the captivity. Babylonia, to them, was home.
Yeah.
And so, most of them, just like most of us, stayed in their comfort zone. And they stayed in Babylon. But Ezra did leave some of them to go back and to try and revitalize the work that Zerubbabel had begun but had fallen short. And he went back, and once again he had an energetic and an excited group, and they made some immediate headway, and then they began to overcome, to encounter obstacles and everything, and they failed to overcome, and the work once again stalled. Ezra mainly succeeded in getting the temple rebuilt and reestablishing the regular worship services there. It never got any further than that, really. It fell to Nehemiah to come several years after Ezra and to begin the work that would actually succeed as far as restoring Jerusalem and restoring Judah as a kingdom, and most of all, rebuilding those protective walls around Jerusalem. And the great accomplishment of Nehemiah is simply the fact that what had taken nearly 100 years and still wasn't finished, Nehemiah went back, he took a small group with him, he mainly revitalized the group that was already there, and they rebuilt those walls in 52 days. Now you think about that. Something that in 100 years, close to it, they'd not been able to accomplish. Something that two different groups had set out and had put a lot of energy and money and effort into having, but had failed. Now they're able to accomplish in 52 days. And so I just feel strongly that for this congregation, as we are trying to begin anew and as we are trying to change our habits, as we're trying to get out of our comfort zone. I'll never forget going into a small, struggling church and working with them and early on making some of, and giving some of those lessons about growth and activity. One of the members came to me afterwards. It was a congregation at that time when I first arrived that was mainly retirees, older people. That member said to me, he said, "You know, I appreciate your enthusiasm, appreciate your desires, but you can't teach an old dog a new trick." You know what I told that brother? I'm not a dog. You're not a dog. The lie from Satan to keep us in our comfort zone, that you can't teach an old dog a new trick. The Lord can renew any old dog. The problem is not God. One of the lessons I have between now and Mark 6 is one on the power of God. So that'll be either next week or the week after. But this morning I want us to see how those people who had failed time and time again, how they were able to do such a feat in 52 days. So we focus on the success factors that are in Nehemiah. We're just going to go through these very quickly because I really just want us to understand the concepts, the points that are there, that this is what it takes to be revived by God. And it starts and it ends with prayer. Wesley read for us Nehemiah 1 and verse 4 there. That recounts Nehemiah's reaction when he hears the news. You see, the group that had gone back with Ezra, you know, they had great expectations. And so, back in Babylon, the thoughts are that things in Jerusalem will be going well and they'll be proceeding. And I imagine that was a comfort to those who were in Babylon. But Nehemiah gets a report brought to him by his brothers and are very discouraged. The walls have not been rebuilt. The gates are still burned. And he sits down and weeps. And I want to give you a 1B here as well. Prayer is always the first success factor. But there was a second one that was also important that same verse reveals. And that is a love for the Lord's people. A concern for God's will and His glory. Nehemiah is devastated when he gets this news. And I wonder sometimes about how we can come and we can worship, and we can come to Bible class and we can study, and yet, are our hearts ever really breaking for the lack of success in the church? Are our hearts ever really breaking for so many being lost that we see and that we encounter every day? For cultures and societies turning completely away from God, do these things break our heart? Do they drive us to our knees? Because that's what happened to Nehemiah. He let that news drive him to his knees. And for those of you who have been in the class, you know that one of the outstanding characteristics of Nehemiah was his prayer life. Often, more than once in the same chapter, we will see Nehemiah pray. It doesn't matter who you are. It doesn't matter what talents or abilities you have or the congregation may have. It doesn't even matter what talents or abilities you may not have. What matters when it comes to church growth is very simple. Is God leading the way? Because you see, if God is leading the way, then He will supply everything that is needed in His time and its place. But in order for God to lead the way, we have to give it over to Him. And that starts with prayer. That starts with focused prayer. Now, I've asked each member of the congregation to do something. I've asked you to take the flyers. I've asked you to invite people. I've asked you to write out your goals and your desires, to write the outcomes you want that you're praying about, and to write the specific work actions behind them that you are doing, the things that you are in control of. And I wonder this morning how many of us have done any of those things. How many of us have done all of those things? And you see, if we're continually in prayer, not just at the beginning, but all through the process, if we're continually in prayer, then that brings God's blessing down on us. It allows Him to lead, and it keeps us tuned in to what we said we'll do. I remember one of the first things that they taught me many years ago about leadership. And they said, if you want to really get something done, then publicly state that you are going to do it. Now, there are some different rationale that underline that. But the main one is simply this. When we publicly state that we are going to do something, then we feel the pressure of the fact that other people know we've said we're going to do this. If you want to lose weight, one of the best things you can do, it doesn't much matter which diet or techniques that you go after. One of the best things you can actually do is to tell everyone that you're planning to lose weight. And then to put numbers to it, a date and an amount. Because you see, that pressure of everybody knowing that you are seeking that goal, that helps to keep you motivated. And what will happen, you see, is that if you're not making progress, you'll start wanting to avoid those people that you told you were going to do that. I want you to think about that, how that works in your prayer life. When you tell God that you're going to do something, when you tell God that you want So prayer must lead the way. Prayer must be there at every part of the way. And then we do have to do some planning and some preparation. I want to read to you, this is the only lengthy passage I plan to read this morning, but I want to read to you from chapter 2 of Nehemiah. Because I want you to see, as he has, you know, considered what needs to be done, I want you to see how much thought he has actually put into this. He didn't just hear the news and decide that, hey, in the morning I'm heading to Jerusalem and I'm going to fix everything. Then the king said to me, chapter 2, verse 4, what would you request? So I prayed to the God of heaven. Shocking, he stops for prayer. So I prayed to the God of heaven. I said to the king, if it please the king, and if your servant has found favor before you, send me to Judah, to the city of my father's tombs, that I may rebuild it. Then the king said to me, the queen sitting beside him, how long will your journey be, and when will you return? So it pleased the king to send me, and I gave him a definite time. And I said to the king, if it please the king, let letters be given me from the governors of the provinces beyond the river, that they may allow me to pass through until I come to Judah. And a letter to Asaph, the keeper of the king's forts, that he might give me timber to make beams for the gates of the fortress, which is by the temple, for the wall of the city, and for the house to which I will go. And the king granted them to me because the good hand of my God was on me. Then I came to the governors of the provinces beyond the river, and I gave them the king's letters. Now the king had sent with me officers of the army and horsemen. And when Sanballat the Horonite and Tobiah the Ammonite official heard about it, it was very displeasing to them that someone had come to seek the welfare of Israel. I read that whole scene for you because it shows a lot of premeditation. Before he ever asked the king's permission to go and do this work, he has thought out exactly what he will need to do the work. And so he knows that he needs more than just the king's permission to be offered work. He knows that he needs to be able to have the supplies and the materials needed for the building. He knows that he needs some officers, some soldiers. He understands all of these things, you see. And so he puts the time. It bothers me to see people put so much time and effort into planning their lives. And I work with a lot of good planners. But even the ones who have a Christian perspective never even consider putting that kind of time and effort into planning for the Lord's work. We tend to just show up. And so it's vital that we put time into planning, that we put time into preparation. And when you're talking about serving the God, and you're talking about preparation especially, you're talking about more than just setting goals and time. You're talking about your personal development spiritually. You're talking about your personal Bible study. You're talking about working on your ability to defend the gospel and to teach the gospel to the lost, you see. That's preparation that you put into it. I remember when I first started playing basketball, when I was a little boy, and people that know me are sometimes surprised by this because I was known in my youth as a basketball player. But when I was a little boy, I played football, and that was the sport I preferred. But when I started middle school, I went to a middle school where the big sport was basketball. And I had even hardly ever picked up a basketball. And guess what? I was not any good at basketball. But I wanted to be on that team, and I spent countless hours all through my first year of middle school so that I could be on the basketball team. And for many, many, many years, I played basketball day and night, 7 days a week, all throughout the year. So yeah, I had to be
good at basketball.
But I put some preparation. I didn't show up for a game and say, put me in, coach. What kind of preparation, what kind of planning are you doing to be a fruitful servant of God? And another thing that goes along with that, and that I see over and over again in Nehemiah, is that personal responsibility is accepted. One of the main reasons we don't get more done in the kingdom is because we look for everybody else to do it. And I mean that quite literally. It doesn't even matter what you're talking about. You know, any aspect that the Lord's work, you will find if you question the congregation that most people are just looking for somebody else who is going to do that. We need to look to ourselves. We need to understand Wednesday night in our invitation. I talked about the fact that, you know, if you're a child of God, then God will regard you as his priest. Yeah. But we have developed very much a clergy-laity mentality that is nowhere to be found in Scripture. And we think that the elders and the preachers, they're the ones to take care of everything. They're the ones to do the teaching. They're the ones to evangelize. Your responsibility is there as well. Instruction in the Lord should be on your lips as well. But most Christians today just won't accept the personal responsibility for it. There is a verse that we'll see in a minute that I think highlights that. About Nehemiah. But you saw it there from the very beginning. He is an officer in the king's court. He is an official in that court. He is one close to the king. He has a relationship with the king. And yet he is willing to forego all that when he hears about the need. He's willing to put his career at risk. Most people don't want to do that. I think we need to understand that the Lord's church moves forward when each individual recognizes that we have a work to do in the Lord's church. That comes with the next one of establishing priorities. You know, I mean, this is always a problem in all areas of life for most human beings. I know it's always been a challenge for me. And something I do this day, every now and then, when I feel like, you know, being pulled in too many directions and I'm losing focus, I still make myself sit down and start writing out priorities. The reason the church does not get more time and more effort from its membership is because it's not a high priority. And I know you don't want to hear that. Believe me, I don't want to say that. But I'm going to tell you right now, the proof is in the pudding. You can tell yourself that the kingdom is a high priority all you want to. But when most of your time, money, and effort goes into other things, it's not. Because we put our time, money, and effort into our priorities. One of the things that stood out about Nehemiah was the priorities. First for himself, and we saw that in the opening chapter, we put all that up. But you saw it all during the word, both with him and with the people. In chapter 4, a couple of passages, in verse 6, which many regard verse 6 as the thematic verse of Nehemiah, and I don't disagree with that for the last half of it, but listen to it. So we built the wall, and the whole wall was going together to half its height, for the people had a mind to work. And who were these people? Were they professional masons that he had hired? Were they hundreds or thousands of workers that he had brought with him from the kingdom? No, these are the same people that have been there and haven't got anything done. What changed? Well, the only thing that changed was their priorities. Because once their priorities changed, that caused everything else to change. because it illustrates this. So neither I, my brothers, my servants, nor the men of my guard who followed me, none of us removed our clothes. Each took his weapon, each into the water. He's telling you that they had to be vigilant all the time. They had to keep their focus on what they were doing. They weren't even able to do their laundry or their personal hygiene without staying on alert. And that's how high a priority that getting it done was with us. You think about how often we know we need to do something for the Lord, and yet we got to take care of this first, we got to take care of that first, we got to do this. They didn't let anything dissuade them. And then you see that too in this passage from chapter 6. Now it was reported to Sanballat, Tobiah, to Gershom, the Arabs, and the rest of our enemies that I had rebuilt the wall, and that no breach remained in it, although at the time I had not set up the doors and the gates. So the work is almost finished. Then Sanballat guessed and sent me a message saying, "Come, let us meet together at Cherethorim in the plain of Ono." But they were planning to harm me. So I sent messengers to them saying, "I am doing a great work and cannot come down. Why should the work stop while I leave it and come down to you?" Now, here is Nehemiah. The work has been going great. They're making progress. And here are these enemies of Israel that surround Jerusalem and that have been attacking the work. We'll see some more of that in just a minute. But what you need to recognize is that these were the leading officials and the governors of the surrounding region. They are important people. They are his peers in the kingdom as far as his level of officialdom and everything. And they want him to meet with them. And one of my favorite lines in that last statement, "Why should the work stop while I leave it and come down to you?" That's one I've had to quote a few times in my life. People say, "Hey, come look at this. Come do that. I'm doing a good work. Why should I stop it and come and meet with you?" That's the attitude of a high priority on the work of God, you see. We are very easily distracted and dissuaded from doing the Lord's work today by all the other things around us. And then look at the way they were willing to give to the work. And I list this one, not because I'm trying to solicit funds. I list this one for this reason. I learned a long time ago that people's heart is wherever they put their money. People's heart is where they put their money. And so, in the seventh chapter, you have this list giving of how that everyone, from the leaders to the people, everyone was giving to the work. And part of what goes along with priorities and personal responsibility, especially, is risk. You want to know why most of you are not inviting people? Do you know why so few of us study with other people or ask for those studies? You know why in your families and your schools and your workplaces you don't bring it up? You're worried about consequences. Sometimes you're worried about having a negative effect on a friendship or a relation. Sometimes you're just worried about the other negative effects that might occur to you in your school or your workplace. Well, we'll go back to the beginning of Nehemiah. We'll look at verse 11 in chapter 1. "Oh Lord," here he is praying again, "Oh Lord, I beseech you, may your ear be attentive to the prayer of your servant and to the prayer of your servants who delight to revere your name, and make your servant successful today, and grant him compassion before this man." So Nehemiah has heard the news at this point. Some time has gone by, and we can see that he has been praying and fasting every day during that time. His thoughts have all been on the work and the need there. And now now he is finally ready to actually take the step of asking the king about it. And I know we can't really feel the weight of this fully today, simply because we don't live under kings who will cut our heads off at the slightest provocation. But they did. And Nehemiah did. And the last verse there is what really brings it home. Now, I was cupbearer to the king. You see, after he tells you that he gave God this earnest prayer before talking to the king, he reveals how it is he can talk to the king in the first place. Because he's one of his officials and he's in his presence. What you may not know is that under their protocol, if you will, no one was to show emotion before the king, especially any sadness or anything like that. You see, it was considered a great insult to the king to do something like that. And any time you were messing with the king, then there was always the possibility that at the end of it, you might face the hangman's noose or the executioner's axe. And yet, knowing full well the risk, the personal risk, the risk to his career, I don't know how many times in my life people have told me, well, I can't talk about the war, I'll get in trouble. I won't even say much about that. I'll just say that I've been in those war situations too, and I've talked about it anyway, and the Lord has preserved me. Nehemiah is willing to put it all on the line for God and for his service. We see it again in chapter 4 and verse 17, when he talks about how when they were rebuilding, they're having to have the tool in one hand and a weapon in the other because the physical threat of those enemies around them is that great. I heard in the prayer this morning a thank you to God for our ability to assemble without being molested. And a prayer for the country that would like to to have that ability. I honestly wonder, here in the church, all over this country especially, how many of us would be here this morning if there were a threat of physical danger incoming? You know, the reason why, as the old adage says, the church flourished in catacombs and died in cathedrals. The reason for that is that in times of persecution, there is no dead wood. In times of persecution, there is no lack of commitment. You are either completely committed or you are not involved. So the blessing of being able to lead unmolested often becomes a curse to the people of God because we slack in our commitment. Nehemiah and those who worked with him didn't do that. They overcame all types of opposition. The Lord's kingdom, any effort for it to grow is always going to face opposition. The devil will make absolutely certain. And so we can't go along, as people often do. We can't go along trying to grow the church, trying to bring change, and then the first time that we face opposition, drop. But do you know that happens time and time and time again with the Lord's work? Let me ask those of you who have jobs a question. If you quit your job every time you face some opposition or some difficulty or some harassment, would you have a job? But isn't it strange that in the Lord's work, the first time that we face a little opposition or difficulty, we quit. And we don't even think anything of it. We tried. They faced faced rumor and ridicule. Their enemies stood around them as they tried to build that wall and said, look at this feeble wall those stupid Jews are building. Don't they realize that if a fox jumps on that wall, it's going to fall over? This is one of my favorite passages in Nehemiah 2. I'll read you just the beginning of it. When they hear about the good work, he says, they mocked us and despised us and said, what is this thing you are doing? Are you rebelling against the king? And so they were telling him, oh, you're building a wall. What do you think? You think you can overcome the Babylonian Empire? Is that what you think? You think you're so great? You think you're going to reestablish Israel as a mighty nation? And it went on and on from him. This is the one that I really like, though. They've been trying to stop him. They've had no success. And so they're getting desperate. So finally, they send him another one of those letters. But this time, it is a quote-unquote open letter. In other words, they are spreading the word. They're spreading rumors and gossip about Nehemiah. And so it says in verse 6, it was reported among the nations. And Gashmu says, well, Gashmu's talking about it. Everybody's talking about it, right? So it's reported among the nations, and Gashmu says that you and the Jews are planning to rebel, that you are rebuilding the wall, you are to be their king, you appointed prophets to proclaim in Jerusalem, a king is in Judea, and it just goes on and on and on like that, you see. Sometimes we have to face insults and rumor and gossip. And we have to do just what he and I did. We have to ignore them and overcome, or the Lord's work will not go forward. And then they worked together. We won't take the time to read the passages, but there are several lengthy passages in Nehemiah which just describe how this man was working here with his family, and right next to him, this man was working here with this family, and right next to him, this man was working here with his family. It takes working together. That's where the power is. That's where the strength is. But you have to make working together a priority. You have to realize that every now and then your neighbor's going to have your tool when you need it. And, you know, sometimes they're not going to have cleaned up their mess and let some of their trash get over into your section of the wall. You have to deal with those things. But we need to remember what we're to be about. Jesus came and spoke to them, saying, all authority has been given to me in heaven and on earth. Go, therefore, and make disciples of all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all things that I have commanded you. And lo, I am with you always, even unto the end of the age. You see, it's not a question of what are we supposed to be doing. It's not a question of what God's will do.